Hello all. A while ago I made a video about my ceramic heat emitter setup for my ball python terrarium, and for some reason this was watched by over 1,000 people? Okay. Anyway, I started receiving some comments letting me know that ceramic heat emitters are not exactly the best heat source for reptiles, so I decided to do some research. And around 2 hours of podcast and a few articles later, I came to the conclusion that they are, in fact, not the best heat source for reptiles. In case you'd like to know why, here's a short summary. If you don't care and just want to see me setting up the deep heat projector, skip to the timestamp shown. Now, just a warning, the following explanation is going to be quite general, and also I'm a plant biologist, so zoologists don't come for me, please. Thank you. With the exception of a bunch of weird crabs and such living under the ocean next to geothermal vents, we all rely, to some extent, on the light and energy generated by the sun to, well, live. Now, the sun regulates your circadian cycle, which involves signaling to your brain when to become sleepy and when to become active. You also need exposure to UV rays from the sun to stimulate vitamin D production, and sunlight may also positively affect your mental health. However, what you, as a mammal, do not need to rely on the sun for is to regulate your internal body temperature, as you are endothermic, which means you can generate your own heat. However, as reptiles are ectotherms, or cold-blooded, they primarily rely on their environment to regulate their body temperature. So not only do they need sunlight for the regulation of their circadian cycles and metabolic processes, such as the production of vitamin D3, the sun also acts as an important heat source. This means that for the sake of animal welfare, we should try and replicate the properties of sunlight as closely as possible to ensure all of our reptiles' needs are met. Now, the sun emits a wide spectrum of rays, and only one portion of these are visible as light to us humans. Also note that different animals have different spectra of visible light. For example, reptiles can see UVA, while you can't. Now, while this range of human visible light that can be found in your typical household lamp or LED light is sufficient to stimulate a general day and night cycle when provided to a reptile, it does not encompass UV rays, which are on the shorter wavelengths outside of the visible light spectrum, as well as infrared waves, which are on the longer wavelengths outside of the spectrum. And these two types of wavelengths are both very important for reptile health. Now, I'm not going to go into the detail on UVA and UVB because trying to explain these concepts would not fit into the length of this video. Also, they don't produce heat. However, I will say that you should provide UVB lighting for your snakes, even if most snake species can survive without UVB lighting. A number of studies have documented that there are multiple ways in which snakes benefit from UVB exposure. And yes, that also includes nocturnal species. However, we're on the subject of heat. It's important to understand that the heat from the sun primarily comes in form of infrared radiation, and this makes up around half of all energy that arrives on Earth. You also have heat transfer on Earth in form of convection and conduction, but generally the primary heat source for ectotherms will be the infrared solar radiation, which means that this kind of top-down radiation is the kind of heat source that we should aim to replicate in captivity. However, to replicate this heat to the best of our ability, we need to be aware that not all infrared radiation is equal. A common way to characterize infrared waves is by dividing them into three different categories based on their wavelengths. Firstly, you have near-infrared, which is also known as infrared or IRA. Then you have mid-infrared, also known as IRB. And lastly, you have far-infrared, also known as IRC. And these waves have different properties. Most importantly to us, the longer the wavelengths are, the less likely they are able to penetrate past an animal's skin and into their inner layers of tissues. And as we want our reptile to be able to warm their entire body all the way down to their core for optimal regulation of a variety of metabolic processes, it is important to be aware of these differences in infrared wavelengths. Let's rank them, shall we? Let's begin with IRA, aka the best kind of infrared radiation. IRA represents the largest proportion of infrared waves that manage to make their way over from the sun down to Earth. It is these waves that represent the most suitable form of heat for reptiles, as these waves can penetrate the epidermal and dermal layers, reaching into the subcutaneous tissues without substantially raising the temperature of the outer skin layer. From the perspective of a reptile, this is a very desirable way to heat your body. Next up we have IRB, the other kind of radiation that manages to make its way over from the sun all the way down to us here on Earth. Now, IRB waves also manage to get past the epidermal layer or the skin and are absorbed into the lower tissue layers, albeit at much lower levels than IRA. Then lastly we have IRC. As far as I understand, and note that I haven't taken a physics class since 2009, there are no IRC waves that make it through the atmosphere onto Earth. So the IRC found on Earth comes from things over here emitting heat. Two examples of this are warm water and you. Yes, you, fellow human being, you emit far infrared. Now, IRC represents the worst kind of heat for warming a reptile's body, as these waves do not penetrate past the epidermis, that is to say, the outmost layer of the skin. Apparently, IRC waves are blocked by keratin, which is a major component of the external skin layers. This basically means that a reptile basking under a heat source emitting infrared C will not be able to warm its core efficiently. Instead, its skin will become increasingly hot, while its inner tissues will not have warmed up sufficiently, making this a very suboptimal source of heat. Okay, now that that's out of the way, let's look at what kind of infrared radiation is produced by different heat sources common to the reptile hobby. First, let's take a look at one of the classics, a tungsten filament heat lamp. Here we see a breakdown of infrared radiation it produces. We can see a bunch of IRA and some IRB. So, pretty good. Now, let's look at the ceramic heat emitter. Oh. Well, that sucks. By the way, this is also the same kind of heat that is emitted by a heat mat. So both the ceramic heat emitter and the heat mat are bad, and you should probably try and replace them if you are currently using them in your setup. Sure, they may be enough of a heat source to keep your animal alive, but I don't believe they will allow it to thrive. Okay, but what about the deep heat projector? This is what this video is about, no? Well, here it is. As you can see, it emits some IRA, a good chunk of IRB, and a large proportion of IRC. So ultimately, it's better than the ceramic heat emitter, but not as good as the heat lamp. Now, you as the audience may be asking yourself, okay, why did you just spend a bunch of minutes rambling about what kind of heating is most suitable for reptiles, only for you to end up installing a deep heat projector instead of a heat lamp, which is obviously the superior heat source? Well, one advantage of using a deep heat projector over a lamp is that you can run it at night, as it barely emits any light, and will thus not disturb your animal's day and night cycle. This means that you do not have to worry about your reptile getting too cold at night if you live in a place where the ambient temperatures can get quite low, aka the European continent. More importantly, in my case, the main problem preventing me from installing a heat lamp happens to be my terrarium setup. As you can see, I have a wooden terrarium and my heat source is installed inside it. However, this kind of setup doesn't work for a heat lamp, as the bulb will be much too close to the hide. In general, heat lamps should not be installed inside of an enclosure, as this can be dangerous. And they should also be placed under a reflective dome, as this imitates sunshine more naturally than having a naked bulb in a cage. To safely install my heat lamp, I would therefore need to drill a hole into the top of my terrarium and then add some mesh or something on top of the hole to then be able to place a dome with my incandescent bulb inside of it on top of the mesh. Unfortunately, I currently don't have the resources to do so. This is why I decided to swap my ceramic heat emitter out with the deep heat projector as an alternative heat source for the time being. And I have to say, they are very easy to swap out. I decided to order the 80 watt deep heat projector to replace my 100 watt ceramic heat emitter, and it cost 34 euros. You can see on the package here the heat produced at different distances in the enclosure if this thing is running at maximum capacity, and as you can see, it is quite powerful. I decided to test for functionality by installing the deep heat projector into a spare dome I had lying around, and I was able to observe that it got incredibly hot incredibly quickly.
303 degrees Celsius, that is absolutely insane. So guys, that was like maybe 20 seconds.
Which is good, but also means that you absolutely cannot use this thing without some kind of thermostat. Luckily, my ball python was feeling quite active that day and decided she wanted out of her terrarium in the early afternoon. And after she had successfully left the terrarium and installed herself in one of the hides in my living room, I was able to switch off the ceramic heat emitter by turning the temperature in my thermostat down to 24 degrees Celsius, which was colder than the ambient temperature of my apartment, which meant the ceramic heat emitter was essentially off. Then after maybe an hour or so, the ceramic heat emitter had cooled down sufficiently and I was able to remove it. I then installed the deep heat projector in the heat cage and then set my thermostat back to the typical warm spot temperature. And then I was able to run it for a few hours while my snake was not in the enclosure. Just like with my ceramic heat emitter, I was able to control my deep heat projector with the microclimate digital thermostat using the same settings. Though in this case I did switch the setting from pulse regulation to dimming, as this was the most suitable setting for the deep heat projector as it does produce a tiny bit of light, so you don't want it constantly flickering on and off as this might irritate your reptile. Now, once again, my thermostat probe was wedged into a hole that I drilled into the side of the warm hide, so it controls the ambient temperature in the hide, which is still set to 30.5 degrees Celsius. Adding the deep heat projector into the terrarium and hooking it up with the thermostat resulted in temperature gradients that were pretty much the same as before, and I didn't really have to make any adjustments to accommodate this new heat source. And as far as I can tell, and take this with a grain of salt as this is anecdotal evidence with a sample size of one, my snake seems to enjoy this new setup as well. She seems to be spending more time in her basking area directly under the projector, around 1 hour every evening before the lights go off. I do not recall her basking for that long under my ceramic heat emitter, so it appears that she prefers the kind of warmth generated by this new heat source. So, to recap, why should you get a deep heat projector? Firstly, if you have a suboptimal heat source, such as a heat mat or a ceramic heat emitter that you would like to replace, but your setup does not allow for a heat lamp, a deep heat projector could provide a viable option. Secondly, if you want a heat source that you can run during the nighttime, this is also an option for you. Well, this video was surprisingly long and rambly. However, once I started doing research into different heating methods, I realized I would not be able to do the subject any justice if I simply documented the installation of my deep heat projector without providing any explanation on why I decided to switch heat sources. Unfortunately, the subject of proper heating is not really discussed much in the reptile hobby as a whole. If it were, heat mats wouldn't be the most popular heating strategy. I hope you were able to learn something from this. However, if you really want to gain a better understanding on the subject matter, please check out the videos that I mentioned in the description. Anyways, with that, I would like to thank you for watching this weird and convoluted video. Hopefully it was at least moderately entertaining. If you liked what you saw, feel free to stay tuned for upcoming content. Thank you and goodbye.